session today is GAP versus GAPS. I'd like to introduce Rebecca Harrell and Sarah Cortes.
Thank you very much, and welcome to our session this afternoon. And hopefully, you'll get a lot out of the different privacy principles that we're going to be covering today. First of all, I'd like to see, is anyone in here not an auditor? Raise your hand. Oh, a lot of you, okay. So, compliance officers? A few of you of those. Information security officer? Okay. And privacy officer? Okay. Multiple hats. Okay, great. Well, I hope you all get a lot out of this, so we're very happy to have you here today. First, a little bit of information about our backgrounds before we get started. My name's Rebecca Herold. I've been working in this industry for over 25 years, and my background is in information systems, information security, and privacy. I started out as a systems engineer. I went on to become an IT auditor, and as a result of my audits, I created the security program at an organization based upon my recommendations from that audit about the security findings that I discovered over 7 months. Got into privacy around 1994 when they were
Wow.
Okay, did that wake you up? I know that your endorphins were low at this point, so yeah, we plan to do that. But anyway, I've been in this area for a long time, and I've seen security changing a lot. I've also seen privacy evolving a lot, and it's something that every single organization has to address. Even if you don't have personal information from customers or consumers, because maybe you're doing work for other companies, you still need to address privacy, because guess what? If you have employees working for you, you have privacy issues. So any type of personal information needs to be addressed, and we're going to cover a lot of that today. Sarah, you want to let us know a little bit about yourself?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So a little bit about me. I do a number of different things. I'm a doctoral student at Northeastern in cybersecurity research and privacy issues, and I was a senior vice president in charge of information security, disaster recovery, and a number of other things. I've done investments for a while, including during 9/11. So I can tell that a number of you take responsibility in your organizations for a lot of very serious things. And what we're going to talk about today is some risk exposures and some information related to privacy information assessments and laws. And hopefully you'll go away with some concrete information that will help you.
So here are our learning objectives for today. Now, certainly in an hour and 15 minutes, we can't teach you about how to create an entire privacy program, but we're going to hit upon some very important aspects that you need to ensure that you have in place. Certainly, knowing what your legal requirements are for privacy, and that means not just laws and regulations, but certainly you need to know if you're contractually required have certain types of privacy protections in place, and you may have established your own privacy requirements for your organization by the way in which you worded your privacy notices that you put on your website, that you put on your mobile app, that you've put in other places. So you need to know your legal requirements. Then we're going to talk about how to know and why it's good to perform a privacy impact assessment. Now, we're going to go from there into what the components of the generally accepted privacy principles are, the GAP, and that's where we got the title of our session today. This is a very good set of principles that has been around for quite a while. It was developed by the AICPA, CICA, and it's a very good way to audit a privacy program. Now, just an FYI for you, over the past couple of years, ISACA has formed an international privacy task force, and I'm a member of that and have been for the past couple of years. And we are working quite diligently to create privacy principles and show how you can use them to implement your own privacy program mapped to COVID-5 and also in consideration of the cybersecurity framework. And we're really hoping that this is something that will be very useful for members and target date to make that available, because we're going through a lot of, we're still drafting it. When we go through quality assurance, we're going to have a ton of subject matter experts really vet it out. And our target is to get that out in September. So something for you to look forward to in case at that point in time you decide, well, instead of using the app, we'll use the ISOP framework. So it's another option. How to perform a privacy audit using the GAP. And then, you know, there's different types of privacy certifications out there. The certifications can indicate if an organization has appropriate privacy practices in place. One of the newest ones is the one from NASB. NASB is the North American Energy Standards Board. Any of you in the energy space? So have you heard of this one? Okay, this particular certification is great because there's a concern about the methods in which third parties, the utilities, contract different activities to protect the information they've entrusted them with. One of the things I've also been involved with since 2009 is the NIST Smart Grid Privacy Subgroup, and we created a couple of guidance documents. 2010, we released NIST 7628 Volume 2. Sarah was part of my group that created that. We did a lot of research to put that out. And then we put out the first revision of that with a lot of new great stuff in 2013. But what happened was we cover within that third-party risk to privacy. So NASB took basically a lot of our recommendations and incorporated it into an actual certification program. And so we'll talk about that as just one example of many that you might want to consider with regard to getting a privacy certification to demonstrate that you are performing everything that you can actually do within your organization. And then we'll talk about how to determine when privacy certification has actually been addressed. Because, of course, there are certain programs that you sign up for and you self-test to, but you may not actually be doing what that self-attestation says you're doing. So we're going to also talk about some of the documentation you need to have in place. And at the end, if you have time, and I'm hoping you'll let us know like 5 minutes before at the end of everything, we'll take questions, and certainly we'll take questions throughout the entire program as well. So I'll turn it over to Sarah now.